Hey guys, what's going on? Blake Rodriguez with Dream Come True Canine. And on this episode of Blake's Takes, where we cover all things dog training in the pet dog world, we're going to be talking about banning the tool. When it comes to dog abuse cases, should we be looking at solving the problem by banning the tool or breed? Or digging a little bit deeper and focusing more on how the method or the dog training tool was applied? This is a topic that I've been wanting to talk about for a while. It comes at a time where we have a couple of videos circulating on the internet where dog trainers are training in a way that in some cases, in some videos, borders on the line of abusive or is clear abuse. The problem lies with the way that extremists tend to kind of attack this situation. Right now, I find myself in a position in my career where I'm being flown out to offer seminars and educate people on dog training methods, dog training tools. And what's kind of 50-50 on the fence right now are aversive tools like prong collars, remote collars, and stuff in the UK. I go out there at the very least yearly. I put on seminars and I educate people from all fields of dog trainers, all different types of methods that come from all different sorts of backgrounds. And by the end, people are blown away, really with the main question, how come there isn't more education on these tools and how come we were led to believe that these tools were such a bad thing when you're showing us that they could be used in a way that's actually clearly safer for the dog, humane for the dog, and in this case, probably something that's saving the dog's life. People are so quick to judge a tool, but what you're not seeing are people outrage and trying to ban certain tools like food. The most widely abused dog training tool today, hands down, is dog food. But what you're not seeing is people saying ban dog food, we shouldn't be using food to train dogs because we understand the benefits of using food to train dogs. Certain tools like harnesses. You'll find harness cases where harnesses were embedded in dogs and their shoulders and everything are just like gruesome stitched up, but people aren't out to ban the harness because they understand that the harness can be used in a more humane fashion. When we're looking at abuse cases, we have to look at how certain tools were being used, how they were applied by a case-by-case situation, because more often than not, you'll find out it's really not the tool that is the bad guy or to blame in this situation, it's more how the tool was applied. So when it comes to prong collars and remote collars and stuff like that, it's really not much different. Can these tools be abusive? Can they be used in an abusive manner? 100%, absolutely. But does that mean we should be out to ban them, or should we be out to say, you know what? This is something we have to be careful with. Let's see the pros or the potential pros to this. Let's see if it's possible to use this in a humane manner and what the benefits of that can be. With all these videos of dog abuse cases and anybody that can become a trainer today, I think it is important that we start looking toward regulating the industry because right now it's unregulated and anyone and their mother can be a dog trainer. The problem and the reason why so many people are not gung-ho for regulation right now is because people are scared about who's going to be appointed that position. And the reality is, if someone gets appointed that position that has the mindset of ban the tool, ban the breed, we're in trouble. Because I can tell you right now, it's not the tool and it's certainly not the breed. But a lot of naive people and a lot of people that I think deep down want to help dogs and want to do what's right are so quick to jump to conclusions without really understanding what's going on that they're putting the industry in a position where little by little we're being restrained from the type of tools that we might be able to use that might be able to help owners and might be able to help dogs. And it's not really about like, can you train a dog with or without a tool? Because the reality is there's going to be a lot of like really good trainers that don't need these tools to be able to help dogs, but it could be far less stressful for a dog. It could be far easier for a dog handler or a dog owner to understand how to replicate what dog trainers are doing when they're using tools such as saddle and reins, even though the professionals like maybe myself and other people are able to train a dog or ride a horse bareback. Just because we can ride a horse bareback doesn't mean we shouldn't be benefiting benefiting from these tools that can make it less stressful on the horse, in this case the dog, and less stressful on the person that's learning to ride horseback. So these are things that we really have to look at. You look at this video with the abuse with the harness, that was clear abuse by way of harness, but the harness is not the criminal in this situation, and the harness isn't something that we should be after. Same thing with food. Obesity is something in dogs that would not exist if it wasn't for us. Dogs are obese because of the massive amount of portions that we are using to feed dogs, to treat dogs, to try to teach them things. That does not mean that it shouldn't be used and there's not a good way or a good manner, a good way to actually apply that dog training tool. We just have to understand the pros and cons of it. We have to be doing the same things and we have to be very mindful when it comes to dog training tools and dog breeds, because you're going to find yourself in a really rough situation down the road when you're limited on what you can use, and now we're quick to resort to drugging a dog, or we're quick to resort to returning a dog to rescues, or we're quick to resort to euthanizing these dogs that don't need to be struggling with majority of the issues that they are, but now these owners, and in some case these trainers, were limited on the tools that they can work with because some extremists went out of their way and found out that a tool could be used improperly, so they went out and banned it entirely. This is not the direction that you want dog training to head in if you truly want to be helping dogs, saving dog lives, and helping dog owners to develop better relationships with their dogs. The industry is heading in a direction where we're taking people's word for it versus looking at the actual footage, looking at the actual science, the actual studies, looking at the actual before after videos of people who are really putting in the work and showing you dramatic changes in dogs versus people who are just talking about it. We should not be out to ban this harness because in this case, the dog was abused by way of harness. We should not be out to ban food. We also shouldn't be out to ban prong collars and remote collars just because they can be used inappropriately. They actually are very misunderstood tools and phenomenal tools when you understand how to use them well. So we need to be in the business of appointing people who understand both the pros and cons and understand and have the ability to educate people on how tools could be used properly, should be used properly, if at all. In this video here, I'm working a puppy on remote collar. Puppy didn't even have behavior problems. We were just using it as a communication piece. And when you understand relationship building and you understand reinforcement, we're actually using this in a reinforcement-based foundation at the moment. Another thing that you're looking at is the footage of us using food, understanding verbal markers. We understand the science behind all this stuff. This is a happy-go-lucky dog in this video. Happy, tail wagging, compliant, understands what's going on. We're communicating clearly, and make no mistake about it, we're remote collar training in this video of what you're seeing right here. All of this stuff are the things that we teach. All of this stuff are public free videos that are out there, and I go out of my way to show these videos. Here's the phenomenal stuff that we could do with a tool like this, because the experiences that I'm having with my dog and the places that I'm able to take him as a result of understanding how to fully embrace dog training tools to make things easier for dogs to comprehend and understand put me in a position where, like, I can include my dogs in everyday real world situations, even around distractions, and they're not stressed. They understand what I'm telling them. I'm essentially hands off at this point, and it's because I understand the benefits and I understand the science behind how to reinforce, how to punish, the pros and cons of certain tools, when to use them, when to apply them, how to apply them when you're in a teaching phase versus when you're in an enforcing phase. These things are important things to know. And this is what we should be educating the public on, rather than being so out to ban a tool. We have to understand where some shortcuts might be harmful, where some shortcuts might be saving dogs' lives, some shortcuts might allow a dog to enjoy a life where they get to be included in things that they weren't previously, faster than they might have before. And then also understand, with tools that are being labeled as shortcuts, the fundamental process that goes into teaching these tools before we use these tools. You'll find out that they're actually far from shortcuts. This is why I go out of my way to not only post these videos on our Instagram page, on our YouTube page, but also on the Consider the Dog website. The majority of people that are out to ban shock collars are thinking that the remote collar is used purely as just a shock collar, right? If you're calling it that, you're probably using it that way. If you're saying that prong collars are mean and stuff, I understand it. I thought so too, until I learned, wow, it could be used this way and this is actually more humane and safer. I had no clue based off its physical appearance. I thought that it was something that was inhumane until I took the time to have an open mind and learn about the tool. So before we're so quick to jump into following what the extremists say, we have to really do a better job of educating ourselves and understanding these tools for what they actually are versus how they're being painted by extremists that know little to nothing about them. Thanks for watching, guys. I'll see you on the next episode of Blake's Takes.